Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Jesus or Muhammad, the greatest show in history. I'm here tonight with my friends Sam Shamoon and C.L. Edwards. You all know them. And we're going to have a special guest here in a few minutes, Anthony Rogers, who we're convinced is one of the best Christian apologists out there. But you haven't seen him before here, and tonight we'll show you what he's got for us. We're going to be focusing on a very important passage in the Quran. In fact, if you're going to, as a Christian, if you're going to look at a passage of the Quran to understand the Muslim position on Christianity, it's probably the most important passage you can look into. It's Surah 4, verse 157 through verse 158. This is the passage that talks about the crucifixion of Jesus. It gives what Muslims believe to be the Jewish reaction to what happened with Jesus. And so it's a very interesting passage, and it's a passage that allows us to test Islam. Now, what do I mean here? Well, think about this. There are certain things that we can investigate directly. So let's take something like the Trinity. Muslims say God is not a Trinity. Christians say God is a Trinity. That's not something that we can look at directly. You can't put God under a microscope and see, well, he is a Trinity. We examined it scientifically and we found that God is a Trinity. You can't do that. But there are situations where we can directly investigate something because a certain claim is made that allows us to investigate it directly. And Jesus' crucifixion, the Jewish response to Jesus, these are things that we can investigate directly. And so here in the Quran, in Surah 4, claims about Jesus and about the Jews and what Jews were saying about Jesus, all these claims are being made, and it allows us to investigate what really happened to see if Islam matches up. And if Islam lines up, well, then Islam is right on the money. And if Islam doesn't line up, well, Islam's got a problem. So we're going to look at this passage. I'm going to begin by asking our brother CL to tell us a little bit about what his view was of this passage about Jesus. Because our friend is a former Muslim, he was a Salafi up until just several months ago. And so, brother CL, what did you think about this passage in the Quran?
Well, Dave, as Muslims, we always believe that this text here was like a damning proof against Christianity, you know, because, you know, the whole thing is if Jesus dies and he's resurrected, you kind of throw out all the claims of Islam, you know, but you have to have something to dismiss the claims of Christianity. So we used to love to quote this to show, listen, you Christians, you've got it dead wrong. Also, this was, you know, it was thought to be like knowledge that Muhammad had that other people just didn't have, which was a proof of his prophethood. You know, that Muhammad knew this secret that all you Christians didn't know about for the last 600 years before he came on the scene, that he had this revelation that Jesus was never killed, he was never put on the cross, thereby there was no blood atonement or resurrection at all. You Christians have it wrong. We have the real, you know, secret knowledge, and we're here to give it to you.
Gnostics, huh?
Yeah, it's kind
of
like that.
So this is something that really strikes at the heart of the disagreement between Christians and Muslims. Our primary disagreement concerns the identity of Jesus and what Jesus came here to accomplish and what he did accomplish. So I'm going to go ahead and read this passage to you, and then I'm going to hand things over to our brother Anthony Rogers to see what he thinks about this passage. Let me go ahead and read to you Surah 4, verse 157 through 158. And because of their saying, talking about the Jews here, their saying refers to what the Jews were saying, and because of their saying, we slew the Messiah, Jesus, son of Mary, Allah's messenger. They slew him not, nor crucified him, but it appeared so unto them. And lo, those who disagree concerning it are in doubt thereof. They have no knowledge thereof, save the pursuit of a conjecture. They slew him not for certain. But Allah took him up unto himself. Allah was ever mighty wise. So, the Jews were boasting that they had killed Jesus, that they had killed the Messiah, that they had killed the Son of Mary, that they had killed Allah's messenger, but they didn't slay him, they didn't crucify him. It appeared to them as if they did. And those who disagree with Muhammad's position, or those who are arguing about what happened, we're in doubt, but Islam comes to bring us the truth, to tell us the truth, to end our doubts and our conjectures and our disputes. And if that's true, we can all thank God for Muhammad to correct us But if it's wrong, and if Muhammad's position is wrong, well, Muslims need to look somewhere else for the truth. So do we have brother Anthony? Not yet? Okay, well, we're still getting connected with Anthony. Sam.
All right, yeah. Good old Sam. What's Sam going to do right now?
Sam,
yeah.
You have trillions of articles on this, don't you?
Yeah, I have too many articles, but I don't want to give away Anthony's case. Again, before we even begin discussing tonight, as is my habit, I just want to ask the Lord Jesus Christ, our glorious Lord and Savior, the Father's eternally beloved Son, to bless everyone tonight. Bless my brother David. Bless CL. Bless Anthony Rogers and myself to speak truth without error. I beg the Lord Jesus Christ that in the power of His Holy Spirit, He'll enable us to speak with clarity of thought and speech, represent what Muslims believe accurately, and present solid objections demonstrating why the Quran cannot be true concerning anything that it says about Jesus, except those statements that agree with the scriptures, the Old and New Testaments. And I beg the Lord Jesus that in everything we say and do, He will get the glory. We will not seek the praise of men, but His honor, glory, and praise. And that the church will be strengthened through this in Jesus' name. Now, again, I don't want to comment too much on this because Anthony Rogers is a dear brother to all of us. We know him through the websites that we all write for. And on Pell Talk, Anthony Rogers has been gifted by the Lord Jesus Christ in a mighty way, in a unique way, in a special way. And I want the Lord to be magnified through the gifts that He's given Anthony Rogers, and I want him to make the case. But what is interesting, I can comment briefly and let me know when he's on, because I don't want to just keep talking and make it the Sam Shamoon Show, even though they do call me Triple B, big, bald, and beautiful. But anyway.
That's not what I call you.
Yeah, because, you know, you still need to repent of that envy in your heart, but that's okay, brother. We're being perfected. One thing about chapter 4, verse 157, it's ironic, David, that that passage says that those who doubt what the Quran has to say concerning Jesus' final moments on earth are full of conjecture. However, it's actually the Muslims who are full of conjecture, because till this day, the Muslims do not have one interpretation of Surah 4, 157. There are various interpretations offered by various Muslim scholars, not just today, but even historically. Let me just mention one that's very old, that's attributed to Ibn Abbas. Now, some of you may be wondering who Ibn Abbas is. Ibn Abbas was Muhammad's first cousin, considered one of the greatest Muslim scholars that ever lived. In fact, we have CL right here, former Muslim who, by the grace of Jesus Christ, has abandoned the darkness of Islam and has come to the glorious light of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord of glory. As a Salafi, what was your view of Ibn Abbas before I give this tradition attributed to him?
Ibn Abbas was gold. I mean, this is the prophet. Not only he's a Sahabi, he's a direct disciple.
Explain Sahabi what it is for those who don't speak Arabic.
A Sahabi is a companion. You know, Muhammad called his disciples his Sahaba, his companions. So he was a Sahaba, a direct disciple and student of Muhammad. Not only that, he was his cousin. He was a relative of his. He was a part of his family. And third, Muhammad prayed directly for him to receive knowledge of the interpretation of the Quran.
Wow.
And the other Sahaba, like Abu Bakr, used to take him and around the older Sahaba so he could explain the Quran to them. He was just a young boy. Mm. And he would amaze them at his explanation.
And that's supposedly an answer to Muhammad's request.
Yes.
Supposedly, Muhammad invoked Allah, bless Ibn Abbas with wisdom concerning the deen, specifically the Quran. And supposedly Allah answered it and made Ibn Abbas one of the greatest Muslim scholars that ever lived. Hmm. With that said, according to Ibn Kathir, and for those of you listening, Ibn Kathir is considered one of the greatest, most authoritative Muslim commentators on the Quran. You can actually read an abridged translation of Ibn Kathir online for free. Go to the following websites. Go to www.tafsir.com. Tafsir.com. Let me spell Tafsir real quickly. T-A-F-S-I-R. You can find this abridged version online for free, so you don't have to buy the hard copies, which would cost you about $100. That same abridged version is found on another URL. www.Q, Tafsir.com. Q, Tafsir.com. According to Ibn Kathir, a tradition that goes back to Ibn Abbas concerning the meaning of Surah 4, 157 is the following. On the night of the Lord Jesus' betrayal, He was with his disciples. Now, the traditions vary. Some say there are 13 disciples, some say 17, some say 19. They vary. Jesus, on the night of his betrayal, told the disciples, or asked the disciples, which one of them would volunteer to look like him? Which one of them would volunteer to take his appearance, Jesus' appearance, on himself, die in the place of Christ? Whoever is willing to accept this proposal to die in Jesus' place, Jesus supposedly said, would be given paradise. In other words, the disciples were asked, look like Jesus, die in his place, and Allah will give you paradise. According to the tradition, the youngest disciple said, I will. Now, it says that Jesus ignored him because he thought he's maybe being overzealous because he's young, and he's not thinking of the implications, the ramifications of looking like Jesus and dying a very brutal, painful, shameful death. So he asked it again, second time. Again, the youngest disciple said, I will. Again, Jesus brushes him aside and asked for a third time. When the youngest disciple again said, I will volunteer, Jesus says, okay. At that moment, Allah miraculously made that disciple look exactly like Jesus from head to toe. And at that moment, Jesus ascended through a hole in the roof and entered into paradise. So when they came in to arrest Jesus, they found what they thought was Jesus, and then they crucified him. In other words, Jesus didn't die in our place, according to this tradition. Someone died in Jesus' place. Who? His youngest disciple. How? By Allah transforming him to look exactly like Jesus Christ. Now again, that's just one of many competing
interpretations. Let me see if I've got this straight, because this sounds unbelievable to me. Are you telling me that according to one of our earliest traditions, from one of Islam's greatest scholars, that what happened was, again, this is according to Islam, who people, Muslims have such a big problem with Jesus dying in the place of others. Someone dies in Jesus' place, and it wasn't by accident. It was actually Allah's plan.
Precisely.
And Jesus is in on it.
Yeah.
Jesus is in on the plan. He's saying, all right, Allah has a plan, ladies and gentlemen. He can't just save me. Can't do that. Can't just protect me. Can't do that. So someone has to die tonight. Someone has to die. Someone's going to get taken, nailed to a cross. It's not going to be me. Not going to happen to me. Instead, one of you has to die in my place. Do you see the reversal here?
Exactly.
Do you see the reversal? According to Christianity, Jesus dies willingly in the place of others. According to Islam, someone dies for the sake of Jesus in his place.
Willingly.
Yes, right. Interesting. What'd you have?
Well, not just that. I mean, it's making it seem that, you know, the real Jesus, who we know, you know, he cried in the garden.
Yeah.
Right? Because he didn't want the cup. He had made this cup be passed for me, but he took the cup anyway.
Oh, but that's corrupt, brother. Your scriptures are corrupt.
But Isa ibn Maryam of the Quran, he's like a coward.
Yeah.
He doesn't want to take the cup. Somebody else tell him to take the cup for me, you know.
Yeah. In other words, die in my place, and Allah permits it. If Allah is going to let anyone die, why not just let Jesus die?
Mm-hmm.
See, that's the point. Point is, if Allah is going to allow anyone to die, why not simply allow Jesus to die? And if he didn't want Jesus to die, why allow someone else to die in this place?
Mm-hmm.
But again, Allah is the greatest deceiver of them all. And interestingly, the statement I just made is not something that I made up. When I just said that Allah is the best deceiver, the greatest of all deceivers, that's actually stated in the Quran, and it's stated in respect to the final moments of Jesus' life on earth. Chapter 3, verse 54. For those of you who want to know the context, just start reading from chapter 3, verse 42, and read all the way to 59. Chapter 3, verse 42 to 59. That entire section of the Quran is about Jesus, his birth, his ministry, and his final moments. Chapter 3, verse 54 says, regarding Jesus' final moments, and they plotted, meaning the disbelieving Jews, and Allah plotted too, and Allah's the best of plotters. Now, interestingly, this translation translates the word makir as plot. However, I challenge any Muslim and any Arabic-speaking Christian or Arabic speaker, you don't have to be a Christian or a Muslim, you may be a Jew or even a secularist, go back and look at the Arabic lexical sources, and we even provide the definition from the Arabic lexical sources concerning the meaning of the word makir. It's wa makaru, wa makara Allahu. Wa Allahu khayrul makirin. Wa makaru, they plotted, makir, wa makara Allahu, and Allah plotted. And then it says, wa Allahu khayrul makirin. Now, the word makir is defined as deceit, trickster, tricking, scheming, conniving. In other words, it's a negative word. It refers to someone who will use deception, deceit, connive, and use trickery to accomplish his purpose. So according to the Quran, who is the greatest of all deceivers, connivers, tricksters, and schemers? Not Satan, but Allah. And this passage is composed in respect to Jesus' final moments. Now it makes sense. How did Allah out-scheme, connive, out-deceive, right, the Jews? The Jews thought they were going to kill Jesus. What Allah did made someone look like Jesus, and the Jews killed that look-alike, thinking they had got rid of Jesus. And who made them think that they got rid of Jesus? Allah. How? By deceiving them. No wonder the Quran says, Allah is the best of all deceivers, the greatest of all deceivers. In other words, from the Quranic perspective, Allah makes Satan look mild and humble.
I have one quick question, Sam.
Yes.
Because lots of times on this program, we talk about differences between Christianity and Islam. And after this, we'll hand things over to our brother, Anthony. According to Islam, Allah is the greatest of deceivers. Just, I'm wondering, according to Christianity, who would be the greatest of deceivers?
You don't even need to guess. It's Satan, according to John 8:44 and Revelation 12:9. Let me just look at Revelation 12:9 real quickly. Jesus calls Satan, the devil, in John 8:44, the father of lies and a murderer. When he lies, he speaks his native tongue because there's no truth in him. See, lying comes naturally to him because he's the liar. But Revelation 12:9, speaking of Satan, Revelation 12:9, speaking of Satan, says this. The great dragon, which is a metaphor, a symbol for Satan, was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, who deceives the whole world. So who's the greatest deceiver who deceives the whole world? Not the true God, the sovereign God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the triune God who's infinitely holy and righteous, but Satan, the serpent, the dragon.
Sam, I'm looking at the Quran in English, four translations. None of them say anything about deceiving anyone. It says he's the best of planners.
Schemers, too.
Listen, CL, that's why I said on the show, go back to the Arabic lexical source. You'll see the word makr means deceit, connive, trick, or scheme. Moreover, the context is crucial. You just said that you just read four English translations that obscure the meaning. But even the context, if you just look at what it says, when the Jews plotted, was their plotting something good? It's not about Jews, disbelieving Jews, plotting against Jesus. Was that something good?
I would think not.
Was it something evil?
Yeah.
Were they trying to scheme?
Yes.
Connive?
Yes.
That's the context of the word makr. Mm-hmm. Allah out-schemed them. Uh-huh. Right? So that's the context. You can't escape it contextually.
All right. Do we have our brother...